There is hardly a historic event as thoroughly described as World War II. Thousands of books, memoirs, documentaries, and motion pictures have given us insight into nearly every facet of this monumental conflict. Yet, when combined, they can hardly offer a hint of the personal experiences of those who lived through it. Neither a book nor a movie can truly capture the intensity, anxiety, and uncertainty a soldier feels as they face combat and the ever-present shadow of death. These are lessons from history one rarely gets to know. One such is the story of a young Sherman tanker, Irving Bromberg, who witnessed the fury of war up close and personal. The hero of our story embarked on his extraordinary war path from Columbus, Ohio, at the age of 19. His patriotic fervor had driven him to the local Marine Corps recruiting office after the shocking news of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. However, an unexpected obstacle arose. Flat feet led to rejection by the Marines. Undeterred, an officer suggested the Navy, but Bromberg eventually enlisted in the Army at nearby Fort Hays in April 1942. Soon after, Bromberg was sworn in at Fort Benjamin Harrison, Indiana, and clad in the Army uniform, he was shipped off to Fort Knox, Kentucky. Here, he underwent rigorous tank training, mastering every position within the M3 Stuart, M3 Lee, and the M4 Sherman tank. The iconic Sherman, armed with a turret-mounted 75mm gun, would become the backbone of America's armored might throughout World War II. His journey continued as he became part of the 2nd Armored Division stationed at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, assigned to the 2nd Platoon of Fox Company, 66th Armored Regiment of Combat Command A. With their training complete, the tankers prepared for overseas deployment. Bromberg's journey took him to New York, where he attended a characteristically fiery speech by Major General George S. Patton Jr., the commander of the American Army's Western Task Force. Although Patton's name had not yet reached legendary status, his words left a lasting impression on young Bromberg. Patton's Western Task Force was set to launch an offensive in French Morocco as part of Operation Torch. Elements of the 2nd Armored Division would spearhead the attack on November 8, 1942. But Bromberg arrived in Casablanca a month later, missing the initial action. However, the constant presence of the Luftwaffe reminded him of the war's gravity. Following the Kasserine Pass debacle in Tunisia, Bromberg faced combat for the first time. At the time, he was assigned to the 1st Armored Division. In the Tunisian desert, Bromberg and his crew confronted a German tank. "It's not like the movies where they're going 25 miles an hour," Bromberg later remembered. "We were doing 3 or 4 miles an hour." Gripping his 30 caliber machine gun from the bow gunner's seat, Private First Class Irving Bromberg witnessed an enemy tank firing a round at his vehicle. Luckily, the round narrowly missed its target. Bromberg's turret gunner let loose a 75mm round of his own, but, too, missed. However, Sherman's cannon held a critical edge. It was an automatic breechloader. Swiftly, the spent shell was ejected and replaced by a fresh round. Before the German tank could reload, a second shot thundered forth, striking true and tearing into their adversary. With grim determination, the Americans kept up their relentless barrage. The loader urgently called for more shells, and Bromberg swiftly supplied them. The German tank ground to a halt, but it had yet to meet its fiery end. Suddenly, the enemy crew emerged from their hatches, desperate to escape the impending doom. Bromberg squeezed his machine gun's trigger. A hail of bullets cut down the fleeing enemy, sealing their fate. With the immediate threat neutralized, Bromberg's tank roared off into the fray, leaving a trail of dust and victory. After a respite, Bromberg rejoined his unit for the invasion of Sicily in July 1943, the first Axis territory to be assaulted by the Western Allies. General Patton's 7th Army was deployed to land on the Gela beaches. Still, Bromberg's fate took an unexpected turn as enemy fire struck his landing craft, leading to an unplanned diversion to the shore. Lost in unfamiliar territory, Bromberg and a comrade survived on local fruits and the goodwill of passing American trucks. Technically absent without leave, their adventure ended when a division truck found them and returned them to their unit after being absent for an entire 2 weeks. It was one of the brief moments during the war that luck smiled upon Bromberg. Back in action, Bromberg participated in the drive on Palermo, where Italian soldiers readily surrendered to the advancing Americans. The Sicilian campaign was less about intense fighting and more about gaining valuable experience. As it drew to a close in August 1943, Bromberg's division set sail for England, preparing for a new battlefield on the horizon. In England, Bromberg and his unit began intensive training for the impending invasion of France. England offered a welcome change of scenery for Bromberg, a respite from the harsh deserts of North Africa and the hardships of Sicily. However, he couldn't shake the feeling that his time was running out, that he was a step away from becoming another casualty of war. This fatalistic outlook drove him to a 2 week furlough in Manchester, where he sought solace in alcohol, trying desperately to forget the grim specter of war that loomed over him. On June 6, 1944, the infamous D-Day Bromberg was far from the action, as the battle primarily belonged to the infantry, who valiantly struggled to open the draws on Normandy beaches with the assistance of independent tank battalions. Only after the beaches were secured, the armored divisions could be fully engaged. Bromberg's tank rolled off an LST onto Utah Beach on June 12th, 6 days after D-Day. The Norman countryside was crisscrossed with hedgerows and formidable earthen banks topped with trees and bushes that served as perfect defensive positions for the Germans. Each advance was a grueling struggle, as the enemy simply retreated to the next set of hedgerows. Bromberg's machine gun fired at every bush and tree, with each hedgerow becoming a new battlefield. The tank battles took a toll, and Bromberg saw many tanks ablaze beside him. Only a few of Fox Company's 17 tanks remained, illustrating the ruthless nature of warfare. Leadership changes were frequent during this chaotic period. On June 13th, Captain Nicholson fell to an enemy sniper, and Lieutenant William H. Schwartz assumed temporary command. Bromberg, though not fond of Schwartz, recognized his leadership qualities and the chance of survival under his command. On June 29th, Technical Sergeant Ole Mancuso attempted to recruit Bromberg as a bow gunner, but loyalty kept Bromberg with Schwartz. In a twist of fate, a few days later, a German anti-tank shell struck Bromberg's tank, leaving Schwartz wounded. The following day, however, Tech Sergeant Mancuso's tank was blown to pieces. Bromberg's loyalty kept him alive. After a month of heavy fighting, the 2nd Armored Division went into reserve near Carentan, allowing Bromberg and his comrades a much-needed break. Here they had their first showers in a month and received fresh uniforms. On July 25th, more than 1,000 Allied bombers unleashed a devastating aerial assault on the Germans, finally breaking their defense. As the tanks rolled out, Bromberg witnessed the aftermath of the bombing, a sobering reminder of the cost of war. Throughout August, the tanks of the 2nd Armored Division continued their relentless advance across France. Progress, once measured in yards, had now expanded to miles. German resistance waned, but pockets of resistance remained in towns and roadblocks. Infantry often rode atop Bromberg's tank, and he came to prefer their company over that of other tanks. The infantry provided valuable support, carrying bazookas, offering heightened situational awareness, and drawing less enemy fire compared to tanks. The partnership between infantry and armored units was mutually beneficial, fostering camaraderie in the face of adversity. However, Bromberg noticed something that made his journey unsettling: the conspicuous absence of dead Americans on each battlefield. This omission was intentional, removing fallen comrades from view to preserve the morale of follow-up troops and replacements. The cost of war, while ever present, was hidden from plain sight. On August 6th, however, death came knocking. As the tanks rolled along the road, all of a sudden, all hell broke loose. An enemy shell hit the top of Bromberg's tank and killed Lieutenant Schwartz. Bromberg distanced himself, particularly from replacement soldiers who often faced swift casualties. There were exceptions, but the general attitude toward replacements was one of caution. Bromberg tried to avoid becoming close to anyone. As the battles took a toll, Bromberg's usual practices changed. He stopped seeking information about returning soldiers after engagements and lost his cheerful demeanor. The unrelenting combat also had a profound effect on his outlook. With the 2nd Armored Division pushing into Belgium and Holland in September 1944, Bromberg's mental state was deteriorating as he also began to acknowledge the humanity of his enemies. It was a poignant moment that made him reevaluate his perspective. He began to withdraw from his fellow tankers, seeking emotional distance. To many soldiers, the stresses of combat were evident to such an extent that they resorted to self-wounding to escape the horrors of war. Irving Bromberg was different, though. He had a tough time, but was committed to keep going. On October 3rd, the 2nd Armored Division faced the formidable Siegfried Line, a defensive barrier with tank traps, obstacles, bunkers, and pillboxes guarding the German border. Once through, the pace of advance changed dramatically. Stress and paranoia manifested in various ways. On one occasion, Bromberg faced a hair-raising encounter when a German dive bomber attacked his position at night. The plane's siren and the whistling bomb struck terror into Bromberg. There was no defense, and the crew could only endure the ordeal. The landscape changed as the division approached Aachen, the first German city taken by the Americans. White sheets covered most houses, and some displayed swastikas. Bromberg's attitude toward civilians shifted. He fired at anything he saw, viewing everyone in Germany as the enemy. Yet, there were rare exceptions when he spared civilians. As days passed, it was just a matter of time before the war would take its toll on Bromberg. On one October day, his tank got hit, and Bromberg had to abandon it. As he ran back to infantry positions, he stumbled upon a German in a foxhole. Both Bromberg and a German soldier were paralyzed with fear. Coming to his senses, Bromberg managed to reach American lines, only to notice that the German soldier was running after him. Feeling scared and angry, Bromberg took one of the infantrymen's rifles to shoot at the German, but the other men stopped him, realizing that the German soldier was running to surrender. Bromberg was experiencing a combat shock, becoming a physical wreck in his own words. The next thing he knew, he was in the hospital. At the hospital, Bromberg struggled to communicate, and everything felt like a blur. He slowly began to recover, regaining his appetite and putting on weight. Afterward, he was transferred to a hospital in England. Finally, on May 9th, 1945, he was faced with a life-altering choice. Given the choice to stay in England or return home, Bromberg initially opted to remain in England, fearing war rationing and a lack of alcohol back home. However, a fellow soldier contradicted these notions, influencing Bromberg to promptly reverse his decision and board a troop ship bound for home. Returning to Columbus, Ohio, a war-weary Bromberg weighed just 116 pounds, having lost 44 pounds during his overseas service. He shed his uniform and struggled to adapt to civilian life. Drinking, fights, and nightmares haunted him. Even simple tasks like driving proved challenging. Over time, the nightmares receded, and Bromberg curbed his drinking. He learned to drive a civilian vehicle and married Betty Farrell in 1955, eventually having 2 children. He opened a plumbing business, which became his livelihood. Looking back on the war, he acknowledged the fear, but credited it with making him resilient. The war's lasting impact made him calm and undisturbed by life's challenges. One lingering regret was his inability to share his war experiences with his family. Bromberg wished he had spoken to his father and brother about the war, but kept silent. He realized the importance of sharing his story, but had never found the words. As he reflected on his wartime experiences, Bromberg found a sense of peace and resilience within himself. He declared that nothing bothered him, that he slept well, and that nothing could excite him. The war had made him the man he was. and he had come to terms with his journey through one of the most tumultuous periods in history. Thank you for watching our video. Please like and subscribe to the Militology Channel if you enjoy the content. Don't forget to click on the bell icon to be notified for our newest videos. See you next time.